So, welcome back to Numerical Methods. We are still maybe in the middle of the discussion of the Monte Carlo method. But when we look at the application Monte Carlo method as an integration rule, so our first result was here our convergence result. And we already saw that here in the convergence result, the convergence depends on two different quantities. One property is here, how many sample points do we use? So that is maybe linked to the sequence that is used. And the other property is this sigma, which is somehow the variability of the function f. So we had another look onto this when looking on how to generate the random numbers. And we defined two concepts linked to these properties. The first one was the discrepancy, which characterizes how uniform is the sequence. So we were then later working here with the star discrepancy. So, and this is characterizing how uniform is the sequence. And the second ingredient was to characterize the variability, the variation of the function. So that's just a generalization of the classical variation in one dimension to d dimensions. So we had the variation here of the function f. So this quantity v of f characterizes the variation. And then we arrived at a very remarkable result, the Kocsma-Lafka inequality. So which looked very similar to what we had in probabilistic terms for our Monte Carlo integral, but now without the probability. So we can estimate the error, so the difference between the Monte Carlo integral and the true integral by the product of what is the variation of the function f and how uniform is the sequence. So what is the discrepancy of the sequence? Okay, and this motivates now so-called low discrepancy sequences. So this motivates low discrepancy sequences. Well, in the following sense, because the Monte Carlo method had a very nice property, we can add another point and improve the Monte Carlo integral. Yeah? So it was an infinite sequence, an infinite random sequence, and we could just stop at m, we could stop at 2m, yeah, 10 times m, and so on. And we could add more and more points. So we can reuse the points that were previously calculated. This is also important, and we will see this later. I have a session on parallelization. If you consider doing this in parallel on multiple cores, on multiple machines in the cloud or wherever, yeah, then you have maybe an infinite sequence and everyone can calculate a part. And this may be easier to split this sum into sums over subsequences. So if you consider, for example, just the sequence I divided by n, yeah, for different n's, so n say equals 2, n equals 3, n equals 5, then if this here is your interval that you like to discretize, then your sequence looks like that for 2, or like that for 3, or like that for 5, yeah, and you see that you actually cannot reuse the point. So that point here is not used there, or these points here are not used there. So the issue is that we do not reuse previous discretizations. But in contrast for Monte Carlo, sequence, it is that we are placing points randomly. So we are placing 2 points randomly here and here, and then the next point is just another random point. So we just add another point at a random location. Yeah? And then we take 3 points, the three previous points, and we add 2 other points in a random location. And that's an advantage. So we arrive at the question, how can we generate a sequence such that every subsequence of this sequence, how can we generate an infinite sequence such that any subsequence of this infinite sequence has low discrepancy? And this then defines the quasi Monte Carlo method. Yeah? So it is not random, so it's quasi random, but it's still like the Monte Carlo method. We add just another point. Okay, so this is just a summary of my motivation. So if you consider the one-dimensional sequence, so we are in one dimension, xi is I divided by n. Yeah? So then this sequence has a low discrepancy, yeah, almost optimal. It's 1 divided by n. So that's here actually a nice feature. It has low discrepancy, very small discrepancy. So it is almost optimal. Yeah? So depending, you could center it a little bit more. Yeah? So, but if we increase the index n just by 1, yeah, we have to recreate the whole sequence. Okay, so that's a disadvantage. So we like to find now an infinite sequence such that every subsequence has low discrepancy. Okay, so how can we do that? Maybe just try. Okay, so assume I start here with a discretization, and now I start with a point. And where should I place the point? Well, maybe I place the point in the middle. No, that's maybe a good choice to have a small discrepancy. For example, largest possible empty space is 1/2. Okay, so it's not possible to choose a larger space that is empty. So what should I do next? Okay, so I have to choose left side, right side, and if I choose one of these two sides, maybe I choose that side. So then I place the point here. So what's then next? Okay, now it's clear. Yeah? So you see a large empty space, yeah? And you try to fill this empty space. So the next one would be maybe here. Okay, so maybe I draw this now in a different color because it's somehow like the second level of refinement. So, and what's now next? Okay, so you see there are empty spaces here. You can choose where you fill the next empty space. Okay, so maybe I just make a choice. Let's choose that one. Okay, and now it goes on. Okay, so now you could go from left to right and fill it up. Yeah? But maybe that's not so optimal. Yeah? So maybe we should place the next one here, yeah? Because then if you compare the the two regions 0 to 1/2 and 1/2 to 1, you have somehow equidistributed the points between these two regions. Okay, and then I continue, place the point here and here. Okay, so you see that already here from the intuition, yeah, so what you would do, you find some algorithm of distributing the points to always fill, yeah, say the largest gap, and if there are more than one largest gap, so if there are some gaps that have the same size, yeah, then you try to say fill the next one, say away from the other points, so that you don't have a cluster. Okay, can we define an algorithm in mathematical terms that does this? Okay, and here is the definition of the sequence that I just motivated. It is the van der Korput sequence. Van der Korput sequence is a low discrepancy sequence. And the van der Korput sequence, so it is an infinite sequence. So xi in 0, 1, it has a parameter, the base b, and it's defined by this infinite sum here. Okay, so that's that looks strange. Yeah, I cannot calculate for every point an infinite sum. But if you look here at the coefficients, so we have coefficients alpha ij here, so each xi, so there is here the I from the xi, has a series of coefficients, yeah, alpha ij. Alpha ij times b to the power of minus j. And the coefficients alpha ij are defined here, and they are actually representing the index I. So here's our index I, and the index I is represented by alpha ij. So alpha ij are chosen such that they are building up the index with this base b here. So we have this parameter base b, which is a parameter of the sequence, and base b appears here and here. So the alpha ij are between 0 and b minus 1. So the base is an integer and it's larger than 1. So smallest one would be 2. Let's try with an example. So let's consider the example b equals 2. So if b equals 2, this means alpha ij is in the set 0, 1. Okay, so that's what's written here. So, and now it tells me that the alpha ij are given by the infinite sum that represents the index I in terms of this b, yeah, of a polynomial in this b. So what's that? Okay, let's start with let's start with 1. Okay, so actually 1 is equal to 1 times 2, so that's my base here, the b, to the power of 0. Okay, plus, okay, the next one in this sum here representing the index would be 2 to the power of 1. The next one would be 2 to the power of 2. The next one would be 2 to the power of 3. Okay, and I already have achieved 1. So the sequence is stopping, and I have here 0 times that, 0 times that, 0 times that, and so on. Okay, so here a small remark. So alpha ij are equal to zero for j larger than some constant. So actually, this is a finite sum. Okay, so you see also this here is then a finite sum. I just write it as an infinite sum, yeah, because I'm too lazy to define the point where the sum stops. So let's take index I equals 2. So for I equals 2, I have that 2 is, well, 0 times 2 to the power of 0 plus 1 times 2 to the power of 1 plus 0, 2 to the power of 2 plus 0, 2 to the power of 3. So you see again here, these guys are 0. So it is again a finite one. And this here is my base. And the I equals 3 is, well, just 1 plus 2. Okay, so it's 1 times 2 to the power of 0 plus 1 times 2 to the power of 1 plus 0, 2 to the power of 2 plus 0, 2 to the power of 3. Okay, so you see, actually, this is just the alpha ij, it's just the binary representation of the index, okay? It's the binary representation where the smallest bit, yeah, the least significant bit is in the beginning. So maybe a little bit reversed, yeah, from how the computer represents it. Yeah, a little endian or big endian. So it is the binary representation of the index. So these coefficients here, they have a nice nice interpretation. So this is for b equals 2, it is the binary representation of the index. Okay, and if b is not equal to, it is of course the representation of the index in some other base. Okay, so now we have that we choose the point according to the sum, and here in this sum there is b to the power of minus j. Okay, so now let's try what this gives us. Okay, so for I equals 1, it is the binary representation is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. For j equals to 1, I have b to the power of minus 1, that is 1 half. So this means that xi, so x1, is 1 times 1 half plus 0 times 1 over 4, yeah, b to the power of minus 2, yeah, 1 divided by 2 to the power of 2, 1 divided by 4, plus 0 times 1 over 8. And now that goes on. So it is x2 is 0 times 1 over half plus 1 times 1 over 4 plus 0 times 1 over 8. So that is I equals 2. And I equals 3, so I have x3 is 1 times 1 over 2 plus 1 times 1 over 4 plus 0 times 1 over 8. Have a look. That's exactly what we did. Yeah. First point, 1 times 1 half. Next point, 1 over 4. Third point, 1 half plus 1 over 4, 3 over 4. That's like what we did before. So what would be the next point? It would be 0 here. 0 here, 1 here, it would be 1 over 8. So the next guy would be, say, that one. And then the next one would be 1 here, 0 here, 1 here. So it would be 1 half plus 1 over 8. So the next one would indeed be here. No? So this here is the first one. This is the second one. This is the third one. And that would be number 4. And that would be number 5. And that would be number 5 here. Okay, so we have these points. Okay, so now the slide is a little bit crowded, yeah, but I believe the formula looked quite strange and the algorithm is maybe quite obvious, yeah. So, and that's the van der Korput sequence. So here are the first four elements of the van der Korput sequence with base 2. So exactly what I have described. So you start by defining the index in terms of, or representing the index in terms of a base B representation, a binary representation of B equals 2. And from the coefficients, you build up the point by taking the finer and finer discretization levels. Yeah, and since you take the sum, you don't hit the point, the previous point again. And below, you also find the sequence, for example, here for base 10, yeah, which is maybe even also very obvious. Base 10 is that you have, say, the coefficients are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then you switch to the next level, yeah, so then it's 1 times 10. Yeah. And 1 times 10 plus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then you get exactly this sequence here of refinements. So you can prove that the discrepancy of this sequence is log n divided by n. So I just give you here the reference, so we cannot go into so much details. I mean, there are books over low discrepancy sequences. So, and this is already quite a nice property. Yeah, it is not as good as the sequence xi, which is just I divided by n. Yeah. I know that this sequence has discrepancy order 1 divided by n, but this sequence has the property that I have to recreate it for every n. But it is better than what we had for the Monte Carlo convergence rate. So it is better than order 1 divided by square root of n for the pseudo random numbers. So this sequence has two nice properties. So the first one, I already mentioned it. We can make the sequence longer by just adding another point. So it's nice that here we can improve the accuracy of our Monte Carlo result by just adding new evaluation points. And another nice aspect is that we can generate the sequence starting at any given point. Okay, I have xi is a function of the index. So this is different from what we saw for the pseudo number generators. for the pseudo number generators, it was given the previous point, I have a formula for the next point. Yeah, so for the linear concurrential generator, it was like that. Mersenne-Twister is also a little bit like that. And this is of interest if you like to parallelize the integration algorithm. There's also some term here related to this. So we have some kind of skip ahead feature. Yeah, so you can skip a certain part of the sequence and start at a later point. And that's very easy here because the sequence is directly given as a function of the index I. Yeah, so given the index I, you know the sequence. So skip ahead is also possible for some pseudo random number sequences, but it's not so trivial as in this case here. Okay, so maybe we have some time to explore a little bit this sequence and do some programming experiments. Okay, so the first thing maybe we could look at is how does this sequence compare if we use it in a Monte Carlo integration algorithm. So I like to have a small code session. And the first one, which I like to do here is the following. We perform a Monte Carlo integration, say for example, here of this trivial function here, x to the power of 3 over the interval from 0 to 1. So integrate x to the power of 3 over this integral. So I know that this is 1 over 4 x to the power of 4 in the bound from 0 to 1. So this is 0.25. Okay, so I like to integrate this guy and I use a pseudo random number generator. And I use a van der Korput sequence for base 2. And I use the equipartitioning I divided by n. But I always use a subsequence of these. So I use x1 to xm. Yeah, so if I use a subsequence here of this guy, it will be not very good. Yeah, so it will be that we have this point, this point, this point, this point, this point, and then we stop. Okay, so it's not a very good discretization scheme, but we will of course see some convergence. Before I can do this, I need to implement the van der Korput sequence. Okay, so let's start a bit of coding to finish this session here. Let's start here in random numbers. Well, let's make it clean and define the interface of a random number generator. Yeah, because we will have now more and more random number generators and later I like to maybe exchange them. And so it's nice to have an interface of a random number generator. So, and a random number generator should just give me the next random number. So it just has maybe this method, yeah, it's like a double supplier. But one other aspect, I like to explore random number generators in higher dimensions and maybe just think ahead and define the interface that it gives me a random number generator that can generate a random vector, because we will explore this. And in order to have this, I also need the dimension, yeah, because I do not want to request a point to check what kind of dimension I have. So that's my interface of a general random number generator in multiple dimensions. But here my van der Korput sequence is a one-dimensional sequence. So maybe I should also have an interface that specifically tells me, okay, this is a one-dimensional generator. So random number generator 1D, okay. And this interface, okay, a one-dimensional random number generator is a random number generator So I can just extend this. It's a special version. No? And it has just another method, yeah, so which is maybe next double or get next double if you like, which specifies, okay, this is a special guy. It also has a function that gives you just the next value. Yeah, okay, we will use this for the van der Koppel sequence. And of course, I can already implement here this dimension method because I know it is one dimensional. So I can add a default implementation. So default, and that is, I already know that this guy here has dimension one. And by the way, I can also implement already the get next method that returns the double vector, because that returns just the vector with a single element. So I create a vector with just a single element. And this is the element returned by that method. So now I have a nice family of interfaces. Well, you remember maybe that in our Monte Carlo integration experiments, that was here, we generated here a stream of random numbers, from a random number generator. And if you take a look here at this generate, so then you see that this generate requires a class that implements the interface double supplier. And double supplier is just a class that has a method get as double. Okay, so now if you like that your implementation of the random number generator can also serve as a double supplier to these streams, then your class has to implement this method. So, but now it's by my convention that my method here has another name. Yeah, so I can also specify that my interface extends the double supplier. Okay. And now I have to say that whenever somebody is calling from the double supplier class, this guy here, this should be the same as calling in my method the next double. So I can actually add here I can add the default implementation that this here is just calling my get next double. Okay, so that's maybe now an implementation remark. Yeah, so in case you, there should be a return clearly. So that's just a small implementation remark. Yeah, so in case you, have created a structure of interfaces and like you like to have that your interface is compatible with another one, you can use this to provide here this method. So now our one-dimensional random number generator. So maybe I should fix here this typo. So now our one-dimensional random number generator can serve as a supplier to generate the streams. And so we can use it here in our integrators. Yeah. Here we can use it to do Monte Carlo integration. Okay, so and now I like to implement a first one-dimensional random number generator, and that is our van der Koppel sequence. So I go back to my slides. And I would like to implement a one-dimensional generator that gives me this number xi, given a certain base and a certain index. So let's create this class. So I call it von der Corput sequence. And maybe later I also like to have this implementing here our random number generator 1D. Okay, so you see, he tells me, okay, in order to implement this interface, you have to provide this method, getNextDouble. All the other methods of the multidimensional generator, they are already specified, because I already specified that a one-dimensional generator can serve as a multidimensional generator with a specific dimension. So the only task I have to do is to implement this method. But before I do this, I like to implement here our formula as just a static method, just a static function. Because for a given B and for a given index, I know how to calculate this, this stuff. So let's create here a function. So that's a static function. It doesn't need any knowledge from the class. So it is the Thundercorput number for a given index and a given base, and the base is an integer. Okay, so as a programmer, my sequences start in zero. Okay, also maybe you noticed that when I derived here this, I was a little bit confused. Do I start in zero or in one? So the formula on the slides starts for I equals one. The first thing is I shift the index by one. So the user can call this with zero. Yeah? The programmer likes to start in zero. So then we have to add one divided by base to the power of, and then the level of refinement where we are. Okay, so I have a certain refinement factor. And that refinement factor is one divided by base. So think of base being two, it's 1/2. And the next level, this refinement factor is, or refinement level, is divided again by base. So it will be 1/2, 1/4, 1/8. So, and now I need to build up the value x that I like to return. So let's define the value x. X is a sum, so I start with zero and I sum up all the quantities. So what's the first quantity I add? So I add to x the refinement factor, 1/2. Okay, well, the coefficient in front of 1/2 is the representation of the index in terms of base to the power of j minus one. So I have to check if index can be divided by base. Let's go back here. So let's take I equals three. If I divide I equals three by two, the remainder is one, okay? So I have that I divided by two has a remainder of one. So I see that there is a one here inside, okay? So I know that this coefficient here is a one. So you see that this coefficient here is always alternating, and this coefficient is the remainder of the division of the index with the base. So this refinement factor is there if the division by base has remainder. And remainder, you know, division here is the percentage sign. So this here is the remainder of the division index divided by base times the refinement factor. Okay, so that would be the first level of refinement. So then I have to go to the next level of refinement. So what does this mean? It means that I have already operated on this index, dividing it by base, so I can make the index smaller. So index is now index divided by base. So if I have an index of, say, 4, remainder with the division by 2 is 0. So then I look at the next level. So I look at an index of 2. And I also have to make the refinement level smaller. So it is refinement factor is refinement factor divided by base. And I do that. I now repeat this and add all the refinements to x as long as the index is larger than 0. And let's return this value. Maybe I add here another small test program so we can print the first results. So maybe that should go in a separate test program, but just here for simplicity, let's place it here. Let's print the first 10 numbers. So now I can start in 0. So I print I and then the tab, and then I print the van der Korput number from I and base 2. Okay, so I can maybe now run this. Let's run this. So where did I place it? I placed it here in integration, but it should go maybe here in random numbers. So let's move it. And let's run this little program. Okay, so that looks like what we did. Yeah, 1/2. And then it's 1/4. It's 3/4, 1/2 plus 1/4. And then it's 1/8. And then it starts taking this number and place the 1/8 on top of it. So it's 1/2 plus 1/8. Take this number and place the 1/8 on top of it. It's 1/4 plus 1/8. It's 3/4 plus 1/8. And then it's the next level, 1/16. Okay, so nice algorithm that gives us here a sequence. So let's solve this little exercise here. So I tried to compare the Monte Carlo integration of this function for three different sequences. So let's create here some experiment. So I call this now Monte Carlo integration experiment. Okay, I define my function. So I have to add a main method. So I could have spared this. So I can run this experiment. I define the function. So that is just a unary operator, my function, my integrator. So that is x to the power of 3, x times x times x. I have the analytic integral. So that is 1/4. I take a number of sample points. I don't know, let's take 100,000. Okay. I would like to have a random number generator that is a pseudo random number generator. So I take here one out of this library. So with a certain Monte Carlo seed, yeah, so that I always get the same experiment. And I like to have my van der Korput sequence, but the van der Korput sequence has this function. Yeah, so we are not yet complete with the implementation, has this function that allows me to generate the index. So I use that. So then I have three running sums, the sum with the mathsin. So I called here zero, so like that. The sum with the partial equidistributed sequence and the sum with the van der Korput sequence. So I have these three partial sums because the task was to print the integral for subsequences. So now I want to say the final point here, number of sample points. And I take the summation of the function evaluation. So the first one is the function evaluated at the Mersenne random number value. The next one is the equidistributed sum. So the partial equidistributed sum. I evaluate the function at I divided by n. So it is floating point I divided by number of sample points. The next one is the function, the van der Korput sequence. The van der Korput sequence evaluated, so the function evaluated at van der Korput sequence. So how was that called? Van der Korput sequence, let's just write it. Van der Korput sequence for the index I, and we should choose maybe base 2. Okay. So how many sample points did we use? So the current number of sample points is actually I plus 1. Yeah? Our index starts in 0. It's I plus 1. It's the number of sample points. So the integral with the Mersenne twister, so maybe I just copy these names here and just write integral in front, is take the sum and divide by the number of sample points we are currently using. So I have three integrals here, yeah? So with these three different sums. So here is the word integral in front. So, and then let's just print this. So I print it out. First I print how many points do we use. So that's the current number of sample points. Then we print maybe a tab, and then we print the errors. Yeah? So I print the Mersenne twister integral minus the analytic integral. And then I print the others. Yeah? So I print that one and that one. Okay, so since I have here 100 million points, maybe I do not like print all the guys. So I print if the remainder with a division of 100 is zero. So I print every 100 points, 100 sample points. So I do not get so much output here. And I could also add maybe a nice little headline on top, and then we are done. Yeah, and then, so this here is the number of points we have here, and then we have the pseudo random then we have the partial equidistributed sequence, and then we have the van der Korput sequence. I hope this works. Let's check. So let's run this little experiment here. Okay. So what do we see? So there's still a lot of output. Maybe I go a little bit slower. Okay, so maybe that's nice. Maybe I take another one. Yeah, okay, that's maybe nice. So you see that clearly we have convergence here. Yeah, so the first column here is my pseudo-random sequence, my Mersenne. Okay, it converges. It converges slower. It converges like square root of n. Yeah? So this guy here is already at 10 to the minus 5. Yeah? This guy here is at 10 to the minus 3 approximately. So here it's 10 to the minus 3. So we see the difference in the convergence. You also see that this partial equidistributed sequence, first, it is very bad, okay, and it becomes better and better, but the other ones are, of course, already much closer because they are better distributed. But, of course, in the end, the guy will beat them all, but we have to run really to the very last point. Yeah, then we get the 10 to the minus 7. This is because x to the power of 3 has a lot of stuff going on at the end of the interval. Okay, so you see that this guy here is a very nice sequence filling up the space. You also see that if you have very few points, then sometimes here pseudo-random number generation is better than the quasi-random number sequence. This is because it's random, yeah. So sometimes we can hit by chance, yeah. It's a result in probability. We can hit by chance a better point. Okay. You also, of course, have here sometimes it goes up a little bit, yeah. Here it goes down a little bit because you can have cancellation of errors. That depends on the function, of course. Okay, when we wrote this here, I did not complete the implementation. Yeah, it was for our experiments, it was enough that we have a function that can get the van der Korput number, but still it was not implementing my interface because here the message still returns zero. Of course, we have to fix this. Let's fix this now. So I want this to behave like a pseudo-random number generator where I can just ask, okay, please give me the next number. In order to have this, I need to store the state of the generator. So I need some current index. Okay, so now this is not thread safe. Yeah, I just use here a single long, but don't care about that. So then I need the base. So the base is here an integer. I need a constructor where we just specify the base. Okay, let's make this clean here. So these are private and final, so it cannot be accessed and not changed. And we generate a constructor using the field base. So we can create a van der Korput sequence. And whenever one is asking now for the next number, he will return the van der Korput number for the current index and the given base. And after that, he will increment the index. Okay, so return this number and then increment this index. That's the van der Korput sequence value, and I return value. Okay, so you can write this more elegantly, but maybe it's clearer like that. Okay, so we first calculate at this index the value, and then we increment the index. Okay, so maybe we have a small break here, and then we have a smaller session and continue on this.